We have all been made aware of our identity and our differences, which I believe can be good, as it reminds us of our individuality. We were born alone. We will die alone. And there is no reason we should live our lives under terms outside of our own. But when differences in nationality are used to determine which people have more of a right to see the world, a systemic abuse of moral authority occurs. As an African, I believe an injustice occurs on two fronts towards Africans. The first, when the world imposes strict travel restrictions on us. The second, and perhaps more disturbing, when Africans impose similarly strict travel restrictions on other Africans. This injustice, the latter more so than the former, challenges the idea of freedom or lack thereof. A conflict I realized at age 10 was not uniquely my struggle. I cannot speak for all Africans, but I believe many of us associate feelings of frustration and even desperation with travel and immigration. Let me take you back to 1997. I'm 10 years old. It is a late August afternoon at Gatwick Airport. I bump into my two best friends who, like myself, are connecting through London to Lagos. Our parents have left us to huddle together, and we are excited to demand adjacent seats on the plane. There is a familiar Nigerian energy as we approach the aircraft, which makes the menacing thought of going back to elementary school much easier to bear. As we approach the aircraft, I glance behind me and lock eyes with a 30-something-year-old Nigerian man. He smiles at me, and I smile back. But before the air hostess has a chance to direct me to my seat, the air is suddenly interrupted with screams from behind. "Blood of Jesus!" a woman cries. My friend's mother quickly pulls my friends and I to the side. And as I look up, I see the same Nigerian man I locked eyes with being escorted from the aircraft with a curtain of blood descending from a gash on his forehead. His casual smile remains, and as he wipes the crimson cascade from his face in the same way an athlete dismisses sweat from skin, I see the tiny blade he holds delicately between his fingers. That this man felt compelled to inflict bodily harm on himself as a way of avoiding being brought back to Africa is unfortunately commonplace with migrants who fear deportation. It sounds unbelievable, but it is true. I have another story for you, and in this one, I'm the main character. The year is 2014. I fly into Entebbe Airport in Uganda. I'm flying because it's my friend Grace's birthday, and she's turning 30. It's gonna be great. The first time I visited Uganda, I was escorted through immigration by Grace's family security. But this time, I go at it alone, no guided service. I'm asked to stand in a queue that I believe is quite long. To my right are a series of much shorter queues, all of which were moving quite quickly. That's strange, I thought. I didn't realize visas on arrival were segmented. At the front of my queue sit two uniformed immigration officers, one male, one female. When I get to the front, I hand the female official the form I'd completed, which she takes from me, looks at quickly, before glancing up at my face. "You are Grace Chuma's friend?" "Yes." "How do you know Grace Chuma?" "We went to school together."
"And you will stay in Grace Chuma's house?"
"Yes."
"What else are you doing in Uganda?"
"Well, after Grace's birthday, I'll go back to London, where I live." "May I just ask, I see that in that other queue, which is moving quite quickly, people don't have to fill out a form. Can you please tell me why I have to fill out a form?" This time, the male official response.
What kind of question is that?
And she echoes.
Silly woman, who are you to question us? Just take your things and go.
I smile, but I can't help but feel hurt. More hurt than I felt by the European immigration officers who take an extra 10 minutes to look at every single stamp in my passport, including during this trip to Berlin. More hurt than I felt by the Singaporean official who took me into a secluded room and proceeded to interrogate me harshly for 15 minutes with three military officials before locking me in that room for another 15 minutes without an explanation. This sting felt particularly unique, as it came from people who looked just like me. Both examples, the man in 1997 and me with the Ugandan officials, illustrate a sense of displacement, which I believe is the result of African countries not being sufficiently accommodating of Africans. I've lived on three continents. I've visited over 50 countries. And I have seen how the treatment of certain passports gives agency to a politically correct form of discrimination. So how did we get here? How did we get to the point where a majority of immigration officers across continents, including Africa, feel it is okay to treat people from my continent like second-class citizens of the world? Let's briefly look at Africa's modern history. After decolonization, African countries, for the most part, remained tethered to their colonialists, Nigeria to the UK, Angola to Portugal, Senegal to France. As a result, we collectively developed a fragmented sense of identity, considering our paths to Europe and the US before any connection to a neighboring country. Following the 60s, minimal intra-African trade occurred. But while African markets remained virtually sealed from one another, a vibrant channel of trade flourished between Africa and the Western world. This is the legacy of 20th century Africa, which still dictates our way of life today. Today, I reside in London, a city whose multicultural identity I cherish. Still, hopefully. And as is common with most Londoners, traveling the world is one of my greatest passions. Unfortunately, because I'm Nigerian, I'm subject to travel restrictions which make it difficult for me to see some of the countries that most fascinate me. Ranked number 89 on the Global Passport Index, actually it's 82 now, I checked this morning, Nigeria sits in the company of Kosovo, Libya, and Pakistan as one of the countries facing the toughest travel restrictions. While my friend Asako from Japan can travel visa-free to Buenos Aires, I must submit my passport to the Argentinian consulate 4 months in advance and pay a visa application fee, which feels like a tax. But just think about that for a second. Think about giving up your travel document for 4 months and how inconvenient it would be for your life. You would essentially imprison yourself in that country wherever you're applying from for that period of time until a decision has been made. And that decision is not a guaranteed yes. Prior to my trip to Sri Lanka in April of 2015, my supporting documents included a personal bank statement, a company bank statement, a proof of address, an invitation letter written from a friend of a friend in Sri Lanka, and a letter from my doctor confirming that I do not have Ebola, even though I hadn't visited a West African country in 6 months prior to the outbreak. Despite the obstacles, I always comply and submit whatever is asked of me. Why? Because I feel I have as much of a right to see and discover this planet as any other person. Unfortunately, Africans still face restrictions in traveling their own continent. A Somali citizen cannot travel to a single African country without a visa. US and UK citizens can travel to about 36, 35 African countries either visa-free or with visas on arrival. That Africans seem more tolerant to Westerners than they are to other Africans reflects a troubling bias, one that feeds the business pursuits and wanderlusts of Europeans and Americans, while starving Africans of their own right to see their own continent. Let me give you a few more examples. For a Senegalese woman to travel to South Africa, she needs a visa, which might take 2 to 4 weeks to process. For a Nigerian man to travel from Nigeria to Cape Verde, both of which are countries in the same economic community, at a similar distance as Madrid is to Hamburg, his total trip time will take 22 hours. He will begin in Lagos and then fly to Casablanca before flying down to Bissau and finally to Cape Verde. So what does the ridiculous nature of this journey show? Well, it demonstrates how a lack of infrastructural connectivity complements our lack of knowledge of one another. It's bad enough that the world makes it difficult for many of us to visit North and South America, Europe and Asia. It's even worse when we impose these restrictions on ourselves. The consequences undermine every goal and agenda set by the IMF, the UN and the World Bank, which is to see Africa prosper self-sustainably. International movement, to an extent, mirrors our ability to exercise personal liberties. Bearing this in mind, I've identified three main consequences of restricting the travel of Africans. Firstly, it prevents the average African from wanting to discover the world beyond London, Paris, Dubai, New York. Secondly, it allows for a missed global education for Africans on regions like Rajasthan, Patagonia, Basque Country. Thirdly, and this doesn't just apply to Africans, the decision to selectively restrict travel punishes people for the wrongdoings of a handful of citizens. It punishes people for the policies of presidents and dictators who harm their countries, and it predetermines who is more worthy of the world. You've heard this before, but I believe it's worth repeating. The solution to the mistreatment of Africans is in the hands of Africans. We, as Africans, are responsible for creating an Africa that is politically stable, intellectually empowered, and socioeconomically integrated. As recently stated by the president of Ghana, once African countries start taking themselves seriously, the world will follow. In March of 2018, 44 of Africa's 54 countries agreed to establish a continental free trade area. This is good, this is progress. And will hopefully bring intra-African trade, currently at 12%, closer to the EU's figure of about 65%, I checked this morning. But are signing agreements and photo ops enough? How do we move forward constructively? Here are three suggestions. Infrastructure needs to be created so that travel within the African continent does not require a connecting flight through Europe or Turkey. African states need to have a thorough understanding of their industries so that trade with other African countries is meaningful and so that business and bilateral agreements with the Chinese or the Americans actually benefits both parties. Finally, there needs to be a re-education on Africa and on Africans for Africans, culturally, historically, and economically. These conversations need to happen in classrooms as well as around dinner tables, which will in turn improve the quality of conversations in business and international forums. When all of the above happen, Africans will not need to pursue treacherous routes through the Mediterranean, risk being enslaved or auctioned, or inflict bodily harm in a desperate attempt to stay abroad. We, as Africans, are responsible for creating an Africa that is stable and that presents real growth opportunities. To be sufficiently curious about one another, and to treat each other with respect. To realize that if an American citizen can travel visa-free to South Africa, then a citizen of Niger should be allowed the same right. And it is the responsibility of the rest of the world to resist the temptation to make fast money in Africa and to instead consider mutually beneficial long-term opportunities. And maybe, just maybe, together we can create a world that is more welcoming to Africans, not just Africans, but more importantly, one in which we Africans are welcoming to each other. Thank you.
Thank you.